Hello, everyone. Good afternoon. Welcome back from lunch to the final part of this year's Ukrainian Financial Forum. If there's anyone who can hear this who is still milling around the corridor, please feel free to finish that conversation and come on inside. So we have a small schedule change. We have a special announcement, which is that we have the pleasure of Mr. Brock Pierce, who we were hoping to connect to earlier. But due to some difficulties technically, we've only got him now. And so we're fortunate to have Brock Pierce. Brock Pierce is one of the true blockchain pioneers. He has started a company called Blockchain Capital. And you know, when you've started a company called Blockchain Capital, that's like starting internet.com. You know, you got there pretty early. And he's raised over $80 million and started a number of ventures on the blockchain. Including, he is one of the leading producers, block producers on the EOS blockchain.
Yeah, cool.
So the lovely Kate, the editor of FinTech, who moderated our prior panel on blockchain, is going to have a conversation with Brock now via Skype to New York, where he's sitting. So I'm going to turn it over to Kate now.
Ukrainian Financial Forum. Just a moment. Hi, Brock.
Hello, hello.
Cool. Thanks a lot for joining us.
Thank you for being so accommodating.
Yeah, thanks a lot. We realize it's like early morning in New York.
Not so bad now. It's 8 a.m.
Okay, cool. Thank you so much to be here with us. So we are from Ukrainian Financial Forum in Odessa, and we just finalized our panel discussion about crypto regulation. So we discussed what is happening right now in global regulation and also in Ukraine. And so it would be interesting to know your opinion on do this industry need any regulation at all, or it will kill it?
I guess right now there's kind of two aspects of the industry where adoption is going to come from. One being, call it the incumbent world, you know, the Fortune 2000, the large companies, the well-established economies world. In those markets, most of the adoption is going to come from being integrated into existing systems, meaning banks, almost every bank in the West is utilizing blockchain technology as a way of improving settlement and things of that nature. But it'll often be integrated into large companies in many instances. Whereas in the developing world, the developing economies, think Latin America, Africa, Southeast Asia, parts of Eastern Europe to some extent, this is where we're going to see mass consumer adoption. Take markets like the Philippines, where 80% of the population is unbanked. The question is, which of the economies are going to see the greatest growth from this technology in the near term? Those are going to be places where regulators and local government is supporting the, not that the government or regulators need to support it for it to grow, but when everyone comes into agreement, when everyone is in alignment, it just happens much faster. It's why in the Philippines, it's 5% of the population using blockchain-based wallet, most of them not knowing it, but we very quickly see 20 or 25% of the population. So the big opportunity for regulators is that they have an ability to impact growth in their market. Sensible, thoughtful regulations will drive adoption and drive economic prosperity in those markets, whereas nonsensical regulation stifle innovation. So it's not that regulators are going to make or break the industry completely, but they have a great deal of influence over the growth or the lack thereof in their respective markets.
So if to consider different jurisdictions, which one is the best real case maybe to follow up to your mind?
Yeah, so one thing I would not be following is the very developed world. Obviously, the U.S. has been a a market where regulators' actions have often been mimicked or copied in other markets. But the economic opportunity for the developed world is very different than what it is in the developing world. Copying what is best for the United States, for example, is not what's best for most of these markets, because the economic opportunity in each of these markets is different. I would actually be looking at markets like Malta, for example. You know, if I were in the Ukraine, I would be talking to the Maltese regulators. You know, they're spending a lot of time looking at this market and figuring out how they can benefit from it versus how they can limit regulation to limit growth as they try to get their arms wrapped around it. And so you really have to look at it from, you know, depending upon your market. Do you want growth in your market? Do you want economic prosperity in your market? Or do you want the status quo? And based upon how you answer that question, I would base my decision on that. If you're looking for economic growth, I would be looking at markets that are regulating it with an eye to that future, such as Malta, for example. There are other jurisdictions like Gibraltar, to a lesser extent, Switzerland and Singapore. And then the opposite end of the spectrum would be the United States. I'm an American, so I don't say this in any way to speak negatively of US regulators, but what's happening in the United States is a great deal of regulatory uncertainty exists. And investors, entrepreneurs, et cetera, don't like regulatory uncertainty. And so a lot of the best and the brightest in the United States are moving to Europe and Asia, for example, because of uncertainty. So you really have to say, what is it that you're hoping to accomplish as a regulator? And I'd say the most important thing is to be informed. I spend a lot of time educating regulators around the world because a well-informed regulator is going to make good decisions, whereas an uninformed or ill-informed regulator is going to make fear-based decisions.
Thanks a lot. That's what we discussed just within our panel discussion. So the next question is, 2017, 2018 were years of ICOs. What will be the next big hype and next big trend? Up to you.
Well, hopefully the big trend of the next year is consumer adoption, you know, where we're starting to see real consumer adoption. The first 10 years of the development of this ecosystem has been the development of the underlying infrastructure, call it the bridges, the roads, and the tunnels. We now finally have a sufficient amount of infrastructure, and I mean literally just now as of this summer, where we can start to build scalable applications that can run on this technology. A lot of it has been a bet on the future promise of this technology. And I would hope that the biggest driver of consumer adoption is in the area of financial inclusion. You have 3 billion people on the planet that don't have access to basic financial services. Another 2 to 3 billion people on the planet with limited access to financial services. We're talking about 2/3 of the population of the planet that are lacking the tools that I imagine everyone listening to this conversation has. And imagine if you lost your bank account. Imagine if you lost all your credit cards and your PayPal accounts. Imagine if you lost access to all of your financial services. That's what life is like for most of the planet. So I hope, seeing how great the need is, that that is what we're going to see in the next year. And the example I just gave, the Philippines, is a very good example of that. You're seeing the same thing in Argentina. You're seeing the same thing in Venezuela. I haven't looked at the numbers in Turkey lately, but I imagine the growth rates in Turkey are off as a result of the economic uncertainty around the lira. But you're seeing that throughout Southeast Asia, Africa, Latin America. I think that's one of those great areas. And I would like to note as well that I don't think the ICO market is gone. Mm-hmm. I think the ICO market is going through an evolution now. It's an upgrading of systems. The nuance being that historically, ICOs were built around an architecture that we call utility tokens. Mm-hmm. What you're seeing now, and literally in the next month, watching the launching, the beginning of the first security token exchanges, and you're going to see a dozen of these exchanges, very well-made, mature exchanges, launch over the course of the next year. And so the ICO market is going to come back in the form of a security token. The main nuance being that the investors in these products have rights. They have the equivalent looks like ownership. They have the what looks like access to dividends or royalties, things of that nature. In the early days of the ICO market, they're investing in a way that having faith that the underlying entrepreneurs were producing things in such a fashion that trusted they were going to deliver on the promise, and you were doing so with very limited rights. As the market comes back, it's going to be implementing the things that we as traditional or institutional investors have come to expect and wouldn't invest without. So I think the market will be back over the next 6 months, and it's going to be bigger than ever, because it's going to be securitizing all sorts of instruments, equity of projects that have nothing to do with blockchain technology, debt instruments that have nothing to do with blockchain technology. Places like the Ukraine, for example, this may become the primary means by which the government or underlying infrastructure development is financed.
Brock, last question. Do you believe Bitcoin can be considered like the first global cryptocurrency for mass market?
I mean, it certainly is the first global cryptocurrency. I mean, obviously, the U.S. dollar has been used as a safe investment asset for some time. But I like to describe Bitcoin more as digital gold. If you understand how precious metals were the primary form of money for the last 5,000 years, gold, silver, copper, this was the case because there were very specific attributes of precious metals. It had to be scarce in supply, so you didn't need a truckload of it to buy a loaf of bread. It had to be malleable. You had to be able to take it apart and put it back together again. It had to be fungible. This is why diamonds are not a good form of money. It need to be transportable. It need to be non-spoilable. You wouldn't want to put your money in your safe back a year later and it's rotten. And so Bitcoin possesses all the same attributes of precious metals, except for it's better at almost every one of those functions. And most importantly, from a transportability perspective, you can move it anywhere in the world near instantly. From a malleability perspective, it's instantly divisible to almost any amount you want at no cost and instant. I mean, gold looks more, Bitcoin looks more like gold 2.0 than it does anything else. It's more of a store value than a medium of exchange. It currently, because of the volatility, is not a great currency. But if, for example, you believe, if you were negative on the world's currency markets for whatever reason, this is an interesting asset to look at, similarly to the way that people look at gold as a store of value in times of, call it, economic certainty.
Thanks a lot, Sofia, for finalizing our session. Thanks for joining us.
And thank you for having me.
Yeah, have a lovely day. Bye-bye.
Too. Enjoy Odessa.
Thanks a lot. Next time with you.